Thanks for joining us for Celebration of Worship. First United Methodist Church is a welcoming community of faith that strives to be a place where everyone can belong, believe, and become a blessing. At First United Methodist Church, you can come just as you are to grow in your desire to know Christ, as well as discover your own unique way of making the world a better place at 201 Monroe Street in Jefferson City. We hope you enjoy today's message.
Today's sermon's a little bit different from what it typically is. I'm going to talk a little bit more about some personal things than I typically do. Talk about some of my own journey, my own struggles of faith. I want to let you know, I think I'm talking about some things in this sermon that I've never talked about in any sermon before. And so all of that is just to say that this is my story and my journey, and it is not your story and your journey. And so if you hear things, talk about things, think about things in my sermon that may or may not resonate with yours, that's okay. That's okay, because that's what makes the body of Christ beautiful. We all have our own story, our own journeys that bring us to this point. And God needs each one of us to make the church what it is today. So, having said all of that, I want to ask you to please join with me in a moment of prayer. Let's pray. Oh God, here we are on this ocean of life. Some days are calm and serene and peaceful. Some days the water is rocky and choppy and we feel tossed about. We are grateful, Lord, that throughout it all, you remain our shelter and our calm, that you hold us and carry us above the waters. Oh Lord, especially on this weekend of remembrance for those of us in our country when we remember horrible acts of violence of not too long ago, we pray, oh Lord, for your spirit among us. We pray for your gift of peace in the world and in our country and in our hearts. We pray, O Lord, for those men and women who put themselves in harm's way to try to keep that peace. We pray, O Lord, for each of us, that we may be about your work to help faith in Christ, to make this religion of Christianity be your cure for a violent and hurting world. We entrust this time to you, O Lord, and we pray in Christ's name. Amen. So, as many of us are probably aware, today is September 11th, 2016. 15 years ago today, of course, was September the 11th, 2001, when we witnessed the horrible terrorist attacks that have shaped the history of the world, really, and our own personal histories for the last 15 years. And if we were old enough at the time, on September 11th, 2001, I suspect that most of us remember very well what it felt like during that period of time, right? I suspect if we were old enough, we remember very well today what it felt like during that time. The days immediately after September 11th, 2001 were filled with shock and a lot of confusion and a lot of questions. And one of the biggest questions was this one. It was, how should we respond to this violence? What comes next? Right? How should we respond to this awful violence? politicians and veterans and military commanders and families of victims and churches, religious leaders, we all struggled with this question in the wake of September 11th. How should we respond to this violence? But you know, honestly, that question is nothing new, right? We Christians, we people of faith, we've always struggled with that question. How should we respond to this violence? Not just in relationship to terrorism, not just in relationship to September 11th, but in relationship to all sorts of other things in our own communities, in our own streets, every year, every month, every week brings a new opportunity to ask this question, right? How should we respond to this violence? These last few months, for example, we've witnessed multiple shootings that have gripped the heart of this nation. On the one hand, we've seen shootings of unarmed black men by certain members of the police, and on the other hand, we've witnessed the shooting of police by certain members of the public. And in the face of violence like that, in the face of this violence, how should we respond? How would Jesus want us to respond? So today is week four in week five of this five-week series on religion and violence titled In the Name of God. And it's the day that we have set aside in no way to try to answer that question thoroughly or completely, but at least to wrestle with it a little bit, right? At least to talk a little bit about how God may want us to respond to the violence of the world. And I'd like us to frame our conversation today around this question, a difficult question. When should Christians use force? Right? When should Christians use force? In what circumstances is it appropriate for Christians to use force against another human being? Now, generally speaking, over the last 2,000 years of Christian history, of church history, there have been, you know, three main types of responses to this question, right? Three main types of responses to this question. Response number one is anytime, right? Response number two is never. And response number three is rarely. So we're going to consider each response today in order as it appears on the screen, beginning with any time. But honestly, we're not going to focus too much on the any time perspective because, you know, honestly, frankly, I don't really believe in it. And I suspect most of us don't, right? I mean, basically, the any time perspective says that Christians should use force anytime they want, right? As their first choice, as their best choice to accomplish God's work in the world. I mean, maybe the most famous example of the anytime perspective is the Crusades, right? From the Middle Ages. But it's still a perspective that's around today. It's still around today. Whenever we hear a news report about, you know, somebody committing some vigilante act of violence because they felt it was God's will, right? Because they felt that's what God wanted them to do. That's an example of the anytime perspective. And again, as a Christian, that's a perspective I just cannot endorse, that we, most of us probably can't or believe in. The teachings of Jesus really don't contain much support for that. It's a different story, though. It's a different story for the next two perspectives on our list. For example, there are some passages that seem to support this idea that Christians should never use force. In fact, that is the perspective that I grew up with, the second one on our list. Now, some of you may know this about me already, but both of my parents were Mennonite Christians. Anybody else have any Mennonite in their background? No, we got some in the church. Now, my father was a lifelong Mennonite before his death, and my mother still is a Mennonite, living in a Mennonite community. And most of my relatives are Mennonites, too. And that makes for some really wonderful, interesting things about our family, not the least of which is like card games that will, you know, drive you crazy, because Mennonites love to play their card games, right? But it makes for some other interesting things, too. The Mennonite church was named after this man. This is Menno Simons, right? This is Menno Simons is his name. Menno Simons was a priest in the 1500s in what is now the Netherlands. Menno Simons started the Mennonite church, right? Which I always thought was really awesome that he got to name this church after his first name, right? How cool is that? It'd be like the Daniel Knight church, right? Or the Keith Knight church or whatever. Yeah. And one of the most distinguishing characteristics of the Mennonite church is their adherence to this second perspective that was listed on our screen. The belief that Christians should never use force under any circumstances. The Mennonite church believes it's never appropriate for a Christian to kill or harm another human being, a perspective that is technically known as pacifism, right? Pacifism. This perspective, of course, comes from parts of the Bible where Jesus teaches us to love our enemies, to turn the other cheek. And so the Mennonite perspective, the Mennonite heritage were and still are an important part of me and my family and my extended family. And it also means that growing up, I never really got to know anybody in law enforcement or in the military very well. Because, you know, those were just not careers that Mennonites went into, right? Those just weren't careers that Mennonites went into. My family still respected law enforcement and military, but we were just in different worlds, right? We were in different worlds. Now, that doesn't mean that Mennonites are not brave or that they don't do their part for their country. And I have to tell you one of my favorite stories from my family history. During World War II, for example, one of my Mennonite uncles was drafted. During World War II, one of my Mennonite uncles was drafted. So he went to the draft board, and he said, "Well, I can't fight because I'm Mennonite. It's against my religious beliefs." To which the draft board replied, "Well, that's fine. If you cannot fight, then we will put you to work parachuting into the middle of forest fires to put them out." And that's exactly what he did. Many of the smoke jumpers during World War II, like the men in this photograph, were from pacifist churches like the Mennonite Church. They sent my uncle out from Missouri to parachute into the middle of forest fires in California. And he did it, right? He bravely did it. He also fell in love with a young woman out there in California and never came back, right? So there's that too. So most of the Christians that I was closest to growing up fell into this second category of perspectives on the use of force. They saw it as something that Christians, you know, just never did. But then, sometime around middle school, I got my first real crush. And you know, your first real crush changes things, right? And so over the next year or two of my first real crush, I not only got to know this girl that I had a crush on better, but I also got to know her family better. And they were a wonderful Christian family. I loved their faith and admired it so much. The mother and father loved God, and they loved Jesus, and they loved each other. In addition, her father was also an officer in the National Guard. And so for the first time in my life, I got to know someone who is in the military or law enforcement. And getting to know him was such a blessing, because what I discovered was that he loved God and Jesus every bit as much as my Mennonite relatives. After getting to know this father, I started noticing certain things about Jesus, certain stories about Jesus in the Bible that had never really caught my attention before. Like what we heard a few moments ago, what Keith read from Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7 tells the story of Jesus and a centurion. Now, a centurion was an ancient Roman military commander. And the centurion in this particular story had sent to Jesus asking him to heal his servant. You may remember that from the story. Now, it's also important to remember or to know as background that there was a good deal of tension. There was a good deal of tension between the Roman military and Jesus' Jewish community in that day. So Jesus, you know, could have very easily rejected the centurion's request, right? He could have really easily done that. He could have really easily condemned him. He could have really easily told him to give up his job as a military commander in the Roman army. But he doesn't, right? He doesn't. Instead, you remember what Jesus says and does? He sees this centurion as a model of faith, right? And apparently, the other Jewish religious leaders do too. In verses 4 and 5, the religious leaders talk to Jesus about this centurion, and they say, "He is worthy of having you do this for him, for he loves our people, and it is he who did what? Yeah, who built our synagogue, right? This Roman military commander built the synagogue for us." And then near the end of the passage, Jesus praises the centurion for his faith, for his trust in him. He says, "I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith as what I have found in this centurion." In other words, Jesus saw this amazing faith in this military officer, a faith that compelled the centurion to use his position to bless others, like he did in building the synagogue, right, for the Jewish residents of this land where he was stationed. And I am very happy to tell you that I have personally been blessed to see that kind of strong and wonderful faith in other Christian brothers and sisters who are serving in the military or in law enforcement over the course of my years. I mean, for them, they see their careers as a kind of ministry that they can use to bless others, like the centurion did. One good friend of mine in law enforcement puts it like this. He let me interview him for this sermon. He puts it like this. My friend says, "In law enforcement, a person has many opportunities to assist others in their time of need and to be an example of Jesus. As a Christian," he says, "and as an officer, I never want to use force. I never want to use force. However, in an effort to protect an innocent person, I feel it would be acceptable to use the minimum amount of force necessary." Another really good Christian friend of mine who has a career in public safety, a similar kind of career, puts it like this. This other friend says, "I consider my career as stewardship, using my talents and my interests to benefit others, and also as an expression of my love for others. Use of force," he says, "cannot be something we enjoy. It cannot be used beyond the minimum." There's that word again that my other friend used, the minimum amount necessary. I am so grateful for my friends being willing, right, to talk with me about this, because it's important, right? And I also believe it represents really well this third Christian perspective on when to use force. And that is that Christians can use force, but but only rarely, right? Rarely. You may have noticed that there were really two points which both of my friends made about Christians and the use of force. First of all, they both said that the use of force must be kept to the minimum, right? To the minimum necessary, the absolute minimum necessary in order to protect other people, right? To protect other people. And then secondly, they both said that the use of force is never the desired outcome for any situation. It's never anything that they want, right? Or that they enjoy as Christians. You use force only when all other options are gone and another life is in immediate danger. In other words, the use of force isn't something cool like what we see on TV and on the movies, right? On some level, it's always sad. It always represents a tragedy that it had to come to that point. And it's never something to celebrate. And you know who taught me that? You know who taught me that lesson more than any other group of people? That the use of force is always sad on some level? It's not my Mennonite relatives who taught me that. It's the veterans that I've known in my life as their pastor. I have lost count as a pastor. I have lost count as a pastor of the number of veterans who have come to me and told me over the years that they are haunted by the lives that they had to take in combat. And for each of those veterans who have come to me, that moment of taking a life, it wasn't cool or exciting like what we see in the movies. Instead, it's something that stays with them and on some level haunts them every day. Which I have to say has given me a very special form of respect and love for our veterans. Not just because they had to face scary situations. I mean, that's part of it. But you know, a lot of people have to face scary situations, right? Like my uncle parachuting into the middle of forest fires. That was a scary situation too. Now, I have a special respect and special love for our veterans because so many of them bravely carry private burdens of the heart and the mind that most of the rest of us will never know about, right? And they carry those burdens on behalf of you and me, and they do it for years and years and years, for their whole lives. By the way, I have to say, if you are a veteran, or somebody who's watching is a veteran, and you feel like you're carrying that kind of burden, please know that there is help. That there is help. I've seen veterans who feel that kind of burden, who found help. Please reach out to other veterans who know what you're going through. Please reach out to organizations or counselors that you can talk to. Please know that God loves you very, very much. You are very important to God, and God is there for you. Please know that this church loves you very much and is there for you, and you're important to us, and that you are not alone. You're not alone. You're never alone. So those are the three major perspectives on the use of force that Christians have held over the years. The first one, the one that says Christians should use force anytime we want, is one I just don't believe the teachings of Jesus can support. But the last two, never and rarely, the last two are perspectives that I have seen held by some really amazing Christians in my life. In the never category, I've known amazing Christians in the Mennonite church and in other churches too. And in the rarely category, I've known equally amazing Christians in law enforcement and the military and in other careers as well. And you know what? I, for one, am glad that there are both perspectives. I, for one, am glad to have been blessed to know saints from both perspectives, because both have really important roles to play. In our violent world, we need Christians like my friends in law enforcement and the military who face the violence of the world for the rest of us, who face difficult situations and difficult choices so the rest of us don't have to. So the rest of us don't have to be haunted for the rest of our lives. And to do so in ways as Christians that limit force as much as possible without celebrating it, keeping it to a minimum, using it only as a last resort when another life is in danger. And in our violent world, we also need Christians like my Mennonite relatives and others who remind us why we need those limits in the first place, who remind us that God's dream for us is one of peace and healing for every single human being on earth one day. The two perspectives, I think they complement each other. I think they need each other. Because taken together, they point us toward a better future that God dreams for our world. They both point us toward this kind of future. The one we read about in Revelation chapter 21. Could you read it with me, please, together? See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. See, I am making all things new. Thank you. So this is God's dream for our world. This is who God dreams for us to become and to move toward as a people and as a faith and as a planet. And if you think it sounds like heaven on earth, I'd say that you're exactly right. It is heaven on earth. And it is the call of faith for all of us to try to get there. Whether we are Methodist Christians or Mennonite Christians or pacifist Christians or military officer Christians or police officer Christians, God has given each of us a role to play in order to make that heaven on earth a little bit more real. Thanks be to God. Amen.